Last night was a number of different state primaries, and what do you know, some wins for the left. Notably, we're gonna start with John Fetterman, who won fairly easily against Conor Lamb. You can see the results right there. So look, John Fetterman had been leading for some time, despite going up against a candidate that had a lot of different endorsements from the Democratic establishment and Joe Manchin and all that stuff. Along the way, Conor Lamb's supporters decided that the best way to win new voters was to argue with people via text messages. That's a great strategy. But no, Fetterman won, producing that holy purple map, and he will now be the candidate in that particular race. We don't know exactly who he's gonna be going up against. We will talk about that a little bit later on. But JR, I'm sure you guys got into this on the election coverage last night. Fetterman is a pretty interesting figure, different than other candidates. Judging by his overall size, possibly a different species than other candidates. He's a big dude. But he more closely lines up with the left on a number of different issues. I've read, and I hadn't seen this before, that he actually doesn't describe himself or call himself progressive, which I think is interesting. But his positions in terms of things like Medicare for all and marijuana legalization, everything is much more in line with the left. So that is exciting. Coming off of a couple of primary nights where the left basically lost all of our elections. Good news there in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't realize that he doesn't call himself a progressive or a liberal, one or two?
A progressive specifically is what I had read. I hadn't noticed that, but that's only because you don't often notice the absence of something, I suppose.
Right, and honestly, it should be the kind of the way it goes when it comes to people's broad spectrum of political beliefs and what they think the country is. Once the labels hit, then people just assume everything that the person believes or thinks. And many times they'll be right, because if they get outside of it, suddenly they're no longer within that label. If we could shed those, which I think is pretty much impossible, maybe we'll be better off. Maybe that's just one positive form as well. But when it comes to last night, as far as him winning, also he had the stroke. I'm not sure if you're getting to as well. He had the stroke, he was in the hospital. All these things happened to him, but he's still there to win from that point. And I think it was Francesca last night did point out, maybe it was Anna. I can't remember what point of the night this was anymore. But that his wife then also came out and spoke very powerfully about the things that he's fighting for and the things that actually help people. And honestly, maybe this stint in the hospital, his healthcare issues and things that he's gotten help from, and being in that position of having that, it allows him to have this moment to speak about, hey,
sure,
this is what most Americans maybe don't have the ease of getting access to if it happens to them. A stroke is not just something that happens randomly. It happens to a lot of people, and if either to them or someone that they know. So it helps.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%. Yeah. And I know the Lamb campaign tried to use that in the last days. Come on, seriously. Like, it would be bad enough to win that way, but to lose that way, you stupid losers. Anyway.
Well, this is the question also, John. Like, is this establishment wing of the Democratic Party gonna then back? And they kind of have to, especially with the shellacking. What is it? I'm damn near 60%.
Yeah, no, he won by hundreds of thousands of votes. We'll see. I mean, again, we're gonna debate later on, who might end up being the candidate goes against him. It's a little bit up in the air right now. Theoretically, the Democrats shouldn't like any of those. So like him or not, it's now your duty, your obligation, and in your pragmatic political interest to back him if you're the Democratic establishment. So hopefully that will happen. That said, some are worried about his chances once it goes to the general election. And they're only speaking in total good faith, worried about Democrats. Here is an example of one, Chris Wallace.
While his authenticity and down to earthness, if there's such a phrase, played very well in the Democratic primary, you get to a general election, particularly if you end up with a moderate like Dave McCormick, there are a lot of things that the Republicans are gonna have to work with in going after John Fetterman. This is a guy who is against limits on abortion. He's for universal background checks. He wants to end the filibuster. He wants to legalize pot.
Okay, so I am not saying that there are not policies that John Fetterman has or could have that you couldn't use against him. I don't know literally every position he has. It's entirely possible that there's areas where I disagree with him. But if you're gonna say specifically that he has these positions that are so out of the mainstream that's ooh, now it's scary for the general, you're gonna have to come with some other examples than that. He talked about universal background checks. Poll from just last year showed 88% of voters specifically in Pennsylvania, support them? Did he Google it? Did he even care to? And by the way, this race is to replace outgoing Senator Pat Toomey, who sponsored the universal background check legislation. So not only is it incredibly popular, but this would just be a continuation of the position of the outgoing senator. You have for marijuana legalization, that's a little bit more controversial, but it is it's the plurality position. Only about 1 out of 3 voters in Pennsylvania don't think it should be legalized. Some people aren't sure. I would say, you know, catch up. It's 2022. Seriously, at least have a position. If your position is it's going to be reefer madness and the kids are all going to lose it, okay, be crazy like that. But to say, I don't know if it's deadly or not, that seems like a dereliction of your intellectual duty. And the fact that he would get rid of the filibuster, well, look, we understand how frustrated people are about the lack of the Senate's ability to do anything. Is this really going to turn them off? I don't know. And the fact that he doesn't support limits on abortion, Chris Wallace is looking at the furor people are in over what's happening with Roe v. Wade and thinks that being more on the side of reproductive rights is a dangerous position to be in going into these midterms, JR.
Yeah, well, somehow we're still buying into the whole moderate thing, because he pointed out, oh, he's going to go up against a bit more of a moderate Republican. What is a moderate Republican? What
type of positions?
Yeah, really stop and ask yourself that, because we just automatically have this knee-jerk reaction, say, well, he's the moderate, that means he's more electable. Why? But in the very next breath, we'll say, look how divided the country is. Everyone's going further and further into their own corners. So is it moderate? It sounds like the moderates have the least chance, because the people that are getting elected from the Republican Party, at least, are not moderates. They are extremists. They're radicals, but they're being called just MAGA, which is now the norm of the party. A moderate Republican now is basically a Bush Republican, which is a bad thing. If people forget, Bush started the wars that everyone was talking about and had an issue with and ended in Afghanistan and in Iraq, which was done wrong. That's a moderate Republican now. Ones who don't want people to openly say we're going to turn flip the government upside down and have a dictator. That's a moderate Republican now. And that's going to be someone who's more electable than someone who actually fights for people's rights and things that people should have access to. It's really weird how that's what we're discussing now.
Yeah, 100%. And also, I'm not going to go off on a whole long thing, but just in case we have new, new viewers, I want them to start to question things. What the hell is a moderate supposed to be anyway? What is a centrist supposed to be? I understand that people just accept that, because you've heard exactly. That's what it means. It means that they are in favor of the way things are, the status quo that benefits them. They'll continue it, regardless of whether or not the status quo is itself extreme, insane, unequal, leaving millions and millions of people behind. It's a crazy thing to continue it. If you simply continue it, you get to be the moderate. It's so nice of them that they do PR work for you. Just like the New York Times will just write, this candidate's a moderate. This one's crazy, this one's a moderate. That's just objective reporting, according to them. Anyway, Chris Wallace not coming with a whole lot of evidence right there. But if you'd like more, I guess, evidence-free, fact-free commentary, he's got a show coming on CNN soon. He was supposed to be on CNN Plus, that evaporated. He whined and now he's got a show. CNN, the left-wing news outlet with Chris Wallace.
He's a moderate.
Anyway, he's a moderate, that is true. He's a centrist, really. He's better than us. I feel a little radical.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.